We don't know. Let this be our prayer. When we lose our way, lead us to a place. Guide us with your grace. Place where we'll be safe.
La luce che tu dai,
I pray we'll part your light.
Nel cuore resterà,
and hold it in our heart.
Ricordarci che,
when stars go out each night,
l'eterna stella mia preghiera.
Let this be our prayer. When shadows fill our day,
lead us to a place.
Guide us with your grace. Give us faith so we'll be saved.
Good morning, church. My name is Jaden Kelman, and I want to thank you for coming to celebrate the life of Major John Kelman, my grandfather. This is a love letter from my brother Jason and I to Grandfather Kelman, as we called him. Dear Grandfather Kelman, Jason and I never expected your death to be so sudden. You were dear to our hearts. We will miss your smiling face and your comforting voice. You were full of kindness and always wished us well and to be obedient children. You were a humble man, a strong man fighting till your last breath, never complaining, a man of wisdom and understanding. Grandfather, you were a man of excellence. You will always be an inspiration to us. We miss you very much. You will always be in our hearts. Rest peacefully in God's arms, Grandfather Kelman. Jason and I will always love you. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Mark St. John. I am Major Kelman's brother-in-law. My earliest memories of the man who would become Major John Kelman go back to the 1960s. I recall him as a small boy, then known as Andy, attending an elementary school run by the Sisters of the Sorrowful Mother at the Holy Family Convent in Spikestown. At the time, I belonged to a Catholic youth group that also met at the Holy Family Convent. Since my first recollection of him is at a premises owned by the Catholic Church, it seems fitting that my final tribute to him would also be here at this sacred building owned by the Catholic Church. Back then, Andy and his family had recently moved to St. Peter, where his father became the officer in charge of the District E police station. At that time in our history as an emerging independent nation, the family of the officer in charge of the District E station, the rector of St. Peter's Church, and the headmaster of Corrigan Parish School, tended to be well known and recognized by everyone in the community. So it's no surprise that I was aware of the youngster. It is also possible that I recognized him and remembered Andy because his sister was an attractive schoolgirl then, and who is now my wife of almost five decades. I came to know John much better in the 1970s and found that although he was relatively quiet, he was never shy or lacking in confidence. When time came to choose members of our wedding party, though Andy was just a few weeks short of his 12th birthday, we asked him to join the group where all of the other members were adults over the age of 21. John carried out his duties with the calm confidence I'd come to expect of him. A couple of years later, he came to visit his sister Judy and myself in Canada, and mature beyond his years, was quite comfortable spending time on a university campus where there were no other 14-year-olds. John clearly admired his older brother Ronald, and it was no surprise when he opted to become affiliated with the military service after Ronald had enlisted as a member of the Barbados Coast Guard. The stereotype of a military man would lead a stranger to expect Major John Kelman to have a loud, bellowing voice and to be lacking in compassion. However, he was the exact opposite. His life is replete with acts of kindness. Let us now reflect on a few examples of that kindness. A few days after he passed away, his niece Melissa remarked, "I will always remember the things that he did for me when I was growing up, especially after my mother migrated to the United States." After his sister's kidneys failed in the mid-1990s, he promptly volunteered to be tested and came out to California in order to determine whether he could donate one of his kidneys to her. Perhaps one of his finest acts of kindness and compassion was his decision to be a caregiver to his maternal grandmother in her golden years. There's no doubt that his daily presence was an immense contributor to her living to see her 100th birthday. John Anderson Kelman's kindness and concern were not just reserved for his family. He extended it to those who knew him as a fellow student, as a teacher, and as a leader of men in the Cadet Corps. Here are a few examples of what people outside of his family have said about him. Tennyson Best, who was his junior at Corrigan Perry School, said, "I called him Kelman while we were at school. I heard some of the boys in his age group call him John. I was his junior, so I never called him John. Though a quiet fellow, he was kind but strong-willed. He never put me wrong yet. In fact, he went out of his way to point out the right direction for me, and on several occasions, and I am always greeted with a, 'What's going, bestie?' I was glad he took an interest in me." Corey Worrell, who attended Foundation School but met John at Cadet Camp, wrote the following on Facebook: "Yesterday, I learned of the passing of Major John Kelman. It was the first time I learned his first name. I met Major Kelman in 1995 at Star One Cadet Camp at Lodge School. From then until the present time, I knew Major Kelman as a pleasant, fair, and soft-spoken gentleman and cadet officer. I was heavily involved in cadets for 5 years while at school and attended numerous camps, trainings, and parades where Major Kelman was present. I've never once heard him shout or ever seen him aggressive or angry. I've never heard one single cadet complain for him treating them unfairly or speaking to them in a disrespectful way." Corey Worrell went on to say, "Lodge School has some excellent cadets, and some were mischievous and strong-willed. I was amazed that this pleasant, soft-spoken officer and gentleman was able to manage and lead those cadets, producing some of the best cadets of my time. Many went on to be leaders in the Barbados Defense Force. As an adult, whenever Major Kelman saw me, he would always greet me with pleasant words and a handshake and tell me to keep up the good work. Major Kelman was indeed a gentleman. I don't recall his athletic pursuits, but one person on Facebook commented, 'Another worldview man is dead. May he rest in peace.' I remember him as a boy. Whenever he came into bat, he remarked the crease before he took his stands. He is remarking again as he starts another innings." Prior to that posting, the most frequent comment I heard about his athleticism came from his sister. She recalls that when he was a toddler living at Boarded Hall Police Station in St. George, he had a propensity to run toward the street whenever he was outside. She relives the nightmare of having to chase after him. Since so much has been said about his soft-spoken manner, I will close with one observation about Major Kelman's ability to make himself heard. The last time I was in Barbados was a month before COVID caused the world to shut down. I was standing outside the store in Spikestown, where my wife had run inside to pick up an item. While waiting, I was talking to a friend who suddenly said, "That guy parking his car over there just mouthed your name." Surprised, I turned around, and there was John parking his car. It struck me then that my friend had an amazing ability to read lips. In recent weeks, after hearing all of the references to him being soft-spoken, yet getting his message across, I now realize that Major Kelman had an amazing ability to make himself heard. Major John Kelman, today we still hear your quiet voice and feel your presence. We are gathered here to proclaim, without fear of contradiction, there lies an officer and a gentleman. May he rest in peace.
Good morning, church. I am Beverly Paris, a member of Sunjet Toastmasters Club. No, this is not the end. It is not even the beginning of the end, but it is perhaps the end of the beginning. Relatives of Major John Kelman, other well-wishers and friends, these words, ascribed to Sir Winston Churchill, appropriately describe the end of a relationship that formally began in April 2003 for those of us who were then members of Sunjet Toastmasters Club. At whatever point we met John, we can all say with one voice that we were always in the company of a gentleman who was not easily ruffled, as he ably proved when he was president. No matter what was said, an outrageous comment, something that would cause the average person to tumble or crumble, like the true captain he was at the time, he never flustered, the smile ever present. Gentleman John, according to Toastmaster Angela, was a decent man who possessed all the elements of decency. Toastmaster Eleanor added that he was the agent of a man who was humble and knowledgeable. There was no doubt that he had accumulated lots of knowledge in multifarious areas, but he never put on any airs or graces or felt more important than any other person. As he shared his enjoyable speeches, we got a glimpse of that vast knowledge. Like when he used his understanding about boats to cleverly craft a speech that compared the parts of the boat to a woman's body. We have memories of John, who coordinated our annual treasure hunts, and John, the sergeant at arms. I can vividly recall our first treasure hunt at Folkestone Park on a moonlit night. John talked about that often, and he glowed like a cherry as he related how a certain Toastmaster ran barefooted all around the church point in her zeal to find the treasure first. Thankfully, he was never able to produce the evidence. In his role as sergeant at arms, John created Mobby's cousin and was teased weekly. Every Thursday, he heard that the concoction looked like Mobby, smelt somewhat like Mobby, but had to be a distant cousin, as it had no taste resembling Mobby. Did John become angry? Indeed not. We have never seen him angry. Rather, always calm and very quiet, and to use Toastmaster Erlin's words, very tolerant. John was elected Vice President of Public Relations this current club year. a role he accepted even though he had his medical challenges. He attended executive meetings and assured us that though it was difficult, there would be at least two newsletters. That was not to be, but I am sure that the executive will ensure that all the information John gathered will be the contents of a newsletter in memory of him and made available before we demit office at June 30, 2023. Toastmaster Philip observed that he recognized how much John loved working with youth after the club conducted an 8-week program for the students of the Government Industrial School. The boys' stories impacted him, and he wanted to do more for them. Toastmaster Roger further acknowledged that he looked out for the youth and was intent on preparing them for the wider world. As John aimed at achieving this objective, he gave us at Sunjet the opportunity to be part of the annual summer activity for cadets at Paragon, allowing us to conduct sessions on aspects of public speaking. He also supported the youth at his alma mater, the Courage and Parry School, where he judged the school's cadet company annual speech competition. Toastmaster Lennox remembers John as being helpful and encouraging him when he was a new Toastmaster. Add to that the fact that John rarely said no. At our Christmas lunch last year, when I asked John to be a committee member for our upcoming Mr. and Miss Toastmaster pageant, he readily consented and missed only our last meeting, held the day before he passed. Toastmaster Sonja remembers John as the one who motivated her to facilitate her first youth leadership program and of the support he gave her when she was area governor and division governor in conducting officer training and serving as a judge. For 20 years, Toastmaster John was a committed friend, mentor, comrade, and colleague to us at Sunjet Toastmasters Club, and he performed each role with flawless ease. All of us, including Toastmaster Jasper, who regrets not being here, shall miss the ardent discussions on education, politics, social commentary, and society in general. Toastmaster John fought long. He fought well, and he fought hard, and he left us when we least expected. Now, all we have are memories of the gentleman, events, situations, and times that used to be. Today finally marks the end of our beginning, but we at Sunjet will always remember Toastmaster John. Farewell, sir. May your departed soul rest in peace.
from the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father.
Good morning. My name is Faye Martindale, a teacher from the Lodge School. I penned this poem after Major died, and for him, and I will perform it for you now. A final salute. Major John Anderson Kelman was given a mission in the War of Life. A teacher of 40 plus years, you kept the faith and fought the good fight, guiding boys, girls, and colleagues through the path of life. You took your mission seriously, dressed in full armor, you took flight. As a Christian, you accepted God's salvation and shone bright. Righteousness was your breastplate, and with truth you were girded. Contrary to the image of the warring soldier ready to fight, your whole presence emanated peace in the skirmish. In your capacity as senior teacher, you sought to teach students what was right, causing you to take up the sword and wield words of light. In the classroom, you hoped to ignite the intellect of all who might consider the field of physics a delight. You experience assaults in your combat of life. Whether full assault or indirect fire, you went down to the wire. In valiant, true, heroic vein and unflinching militaristic style, you sounded out, no retreat, no surrender. As the light started to dim, you maintained your posture. Never one to go a wall, you fought life's final battle with pain. In the line of duty, you left an exemplar from which we can gain understanding of sobering strength, fearless faith, powerful patience, and ripe resilience, unrestrained. Therefore, let us not feel defeated even though we mourn. In Jesus' presence, you reside as the battle is won. Although you have departed from our presence here on earth, know that our love lives on in each precious memory rebirthed. Onward, Major Kelman, your march in the war of life is o'er. As you cross the river to the heavenly shore, even though you have left us, we can rest assured that you have a new assignment in God's celestial army. Today, we assemble to offer you our final salute. Rest in peace, Major.
Good morning to you, Sandy, and to all who are gathered here this morning to commemorate the life of our dear friend, workmate, teacher, and commanding officer, Major John Kelman. My name is Vincent Jones. Over the past 2 weeks, I have sat and read many tributes on social media, have had several discussions with persons who have expressed various sentiments of who Major John Kelman was to them. I have sat and pondered the many times that the Major and I have spent together and looked at how our friendship has evolved over the past 34 years. It's funny when you think of your school days, how fresh they often remain in one's mind, how vivid those good memories seem to be, and the smile that those thoughts and memories can often put on your face. Our friendship has taken many forms over that time. First, it was my commanding officer, First Lieutenant Kelman, who was a soft-spoken disciplinarian, who modeled for us that as a leader, that you did not need to shout or berate people in order to get them to follow your lead, that you did not need to exert your authority in such a way that it became a thing of fear, but rather that with dignity and by taking a servant leadership approach to instruction, that you learned not only to respect the rank, but more importantly, to respect the man wearing the rank. Then there was Mr. Kelman, my physics teacher, who attempted to teach me the intricacies of physics in fourth and fifth form. Unfortunately, I was a very weak student in this area. Nevertheless, he always had time for me and did his best to motivate me in the subject matter. But alas, I found it difficult to grasp some of the scientific concepts being expounded at that time. But as always, Mr. Kelman was patient and did his best to explain, never once becoming angry in having to explain multiple times over. Then there was Mr. Kelman, John, my friend. To me, regardless of our friendship, such was my respect for the Major that I only ever could refer to him as Captain, then Major, or Mr. Kelman. I was invited to attend and play the small part in his wedding on his special day with Sandy. Likewise, many years later, he attended my wedding as mentor and friend. Our lives always crossed at my beloved alma mater, or for matters pertaining to the Barbados Cadet Corps. From my being invited to assist with the cadet band when he was seconded to cadet headquarters, or from time to time assisting with the drum corps or some other aspect of cadet company business at the Lord School, or to come and share with his sixth form group for which he was responsible. I was always only a phone call away, and such was our mutual respect between us that he knew that he only needed just a call and that I would be there. Our last project together is yet to bear fruit, but it's a promise I intend to keep, that of finishing a book on the number 2 cadet company. As I look around the congregation today, I can see the tangible evidence of the influence this man has had on so many lives, that he was able to instill in us a sense of duty, a sense of patriotism, a sense of servant leadership. Is a certain complement to a life that was one of service and of giving of oneself. In that regard, one sees how suited that John and Sandy really were for one another, as they are both individuals with a keen sense of service to Barbados and to others, to at times place others before themselves. And in that happy union of 25 plus years, there are lessons for the onlooker to learn and to understand that a marriage that has God at the center and love can survive any storm and last the test of time. That what may seem as a mismatch to some was actually God's perfect fit. So we remember with a smile the many good times, the many parades, the wry smile, the rubbing of the head, and the quick wit of our commander, our teacher, our friend, Major John Kelman. Sir, we salute you today as you stand relieved of this earthly command to assume your new post in the hereafter. And perhaps Sunday again we shall sit as friends, as we have so often done, and chat about those hard years, cadets, and that secret weekend camp, and the lingering mystery of who took the tin of corned beef, and the many other stories that made us reminisce, smile, and laugh. May God keep you, my friend, until we see each other again. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Sergeant Dan Bascom, Sergeant in charge of City Patrol in town. My small tribute is to an officer and a friend who's responsible for all that I have today. Sir, thank you.
This needs to be raised up. It's too low for you. Can you stand?
Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone. We are here, yes, a morning, but also to celebrate the life of Major John Kelman. I am very conscious of the fact that there are a number of officers and dignitaries, and I think being a chaplain in the Army, they know that, unfortunately, I love the Army, but the Lord did not give me the kind of memory, and I don't want to miss out anybody. So to all the officers, all the dignitaries, all of you, special welcome. I don't trust this here, because I know I'm going to forget somebody, and you may not feel bad, but I will feel bad. So welcome to us all. I don't think that John would want an official, he would want a staid, but he would not want a very sad funeral. I don't think he would want that. That's not John's spirit. And therefore, let's celebrate his life this morning, as we welcome him into our church. Please stand. Now, what is happening at the moment, those of you who are in the front, We are receiving the body of John, Major John Kelman, into the church. And how that's being done, the administrator of the cathedral, Father Bybert Stevens, he will welcome the body here and receive the body into the church. And he will sprinkle the body with holy water. I like to explain when I have Catholic ceremonies with a number of non-Catholics present, because people come to our churches and they still do things, they kind of think we kind of funny. Well, that's not the case. Our church go back to the days when we didn't have books. You didn't explain things, you just did rituals. And so we keep that, we keep those rituals. And as a result, you need to understand them. Now for us, John began his life as a Christian in the waters of baptism. And we're showing respect for that body, which holds his immortal soul. So we sprinkle with water again, remembering how he began his life as a Christian.
To say thanks to God for the life of John Anderson Kelman, asking God to receive him and to take him into his kingdom. I bless the body of John, who in baptism died with Christ. May he also rise and share eternal life with him.
Enter into Jerusalem, let us
going to celebrate. We are going to celebrate. Yes, celebrate John's life. As we come together and pray. Almighty God and Father, it is our sure and certain faith that this body of our brother you bring for burial would one day be raised in glory because of your son's suffering, death, and rising. Give us the grace, Father, to be able to let him go, knowing that he will reign with you one day. This prayer we make through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Amen. Forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Be seated for the reading.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will prepare for all peoples a banquet of rich food. On this mountain, he will remove the mourning veil covering all peoples and the shroud enwrapping all nations. He will destroy death forever. The Lord will wipe away the tears from every cheek. He will take away his people's shame everywhere on earth. For the Lord has said so. That day it will be said, "See, this is our God in whom we hoped for salvation. The Lord is the one in whom we hoped. We exult and we rejoice that he has saved us." The word of the Lord.
Fire brought us love. reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. The life and death of each of us has its influence on others. If we live for the Lord. And if we die for the Lord. So that alive or dead, we belong to the Lord. This explains why Christ both died and came to life. It was so that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. We shall all have to stand before the judgment seat of God. As Scripture says, "By my life, it is the Lord who speaks. Every knee shall bend before me, and every tongue shall praise God." It is to God, therefore, that each of us must give an account of himself. The word of the Lord.
We greet the gospel with the alleluias. Please stand. And the eulogists, please stand by. But we have the gospel. Then we please stand for to greet the gospel. Holy Spirit. Amen.
Alleluia. Alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus went to a town called Nain, accompanied by his disciples and a great number of people. When he was near the gate of the town, it happened that a dead man was being carried out for burial, the only son of his mother. And she was a widow. And a considerable number of townspeople were with her. When the Lord saw her, he felt sorry for her. "Do not cry," he said. Then he went up and put his hand on the bier, and the bier stood still, and he said, "Young man, I tell you to get up." And the dead man sat up and began to talk, and Jesus gave him to his mother. Everyone was filled with awe and praised God, saying, "A great prophet has appeared among us. God has visited his people." And this opinion of him spread throughout Judea and all over the countryside. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Please be seated. We now have the eulogy for Major John. The eulogy.
Good morning, church. This morning, I want to take the time to honor my good friend and fellow officer, Major John Kelman. John Anderson Kelman, also known as Yellow Pinky, Little Sarge, and even Jungle Bear, was born to the late Olga Kelman and George Kelman on July 19, 1962. He was the last of five children four boys and one girl. As you heard from his brother-in-law, his early education was obtained at the Holy Family Convent, which in Station Hill, which was at the time run by the sisters from the St. Joseph Hospital. And then he went on to what was then the famous Sibelikot Primary School, famous for getting students into some of the better schools on the island. His secondary education was obtained at the College and Priory School, his alma mater, which he loved and cherished, and would later contribute as first vice president of the Old Scholars Association in the year the years 1986 to 1988. He then went on to the Barbados Community College and the UWI KFL campus. I first met John in the science division of the Barbados Community College in September 1979, where he enrolled to write the University of Cambridge A-level examinations in mathematics, chemistry, and physics. Before we actually met, I remember seeing him on many occasions walking home from Cordon Parry, usually along Station Hill, around the town, Roadview, a distance that I Googled and worked out to be 2.65 kilometers or 1.65 miles. John would not linger at school. He would always head home fairly punctually. We became friends from day one at the Barbados Community College, and our friendship would last for over 43 years until his death on April 12, 2023. Of necessity, we traveled together on evenings because he lived in Roadview, I live in the Garden, St. James, so we were just, and we were doing the same courses, so we would just take the bus together from Howard's Cross Road into the Fairchild Street bus stand, down Broad Street, and pick up another bus heading north in the Lower Green bus terminal. So we really cemented our friendship. Kelly was always a very quiet and reserved person, never the voice of the group or the conversation, but he had a sharp intellect and could be piercing during a ragging session, and we did a lot of that as young boys at college, with his time pungent interjections. He was also an avid photographer, and we had a lot of pictures in those days, but he would be absent from most of them because most of the time he was the person behind the lens. I found that he was always able to influence me in his own quiet way, and John has a way of influencing you if you work with him. I'll give you a first example. Somehow John decided at college that he wanted to be a bodybuilder. And every day in my head, Arnold Schwarzenegger, Mr. Olympia. So before I knew it, John was president of the Barbados Community College Bodybuilding Club. And I'm his good friend. John somehow convinced me, all 120 pounds at the time, to be his vice president. So you have John and Carl lifting weights. And of course, today, I don't think you can see any physical evidence that we even came close to those weights. But that was it. We enjoyed the experience as young men and the activity. I was part of the leadership. At the Barbados Community College, he was also a member of the photographic club, and he was also a good chess player. He was a member of the chess team. On graduation from the Barbados Community College, we moved on to the science faculty at UWI-KFL campus, continuing with mathematics, physics, and computer science. After a year or so, I really was struggling and I had some challenges and I decided I would take a break. But John continued uninterrupted to complete his Bachelor of Science in Mathematics and Physics. And I want to mention some friends that we developed along the way. We had Peter Allen, who continued with us from college. Then we met Clifford Bostick and Jeffrey Jones, fellows who will be life friends because of that relationship at KFL. John joined the Barbados Coast Guard Reserve in April 92 and was constantly encouraging me to sign up. His stories of adventures at sea with the late Lieutenant Commander Seekins, who was also a lecturer in chemistry at the time at KFL, were always exciting. In April 1994, I decided then, after being convinced by John, that I was sent to join the regiment. But before I could begin that journey, a very interesting development occurred, which will force an even greater bond between John and I. That year, the Barbados Defense Force, with obvious support from the Ministry of Education, sought to recruit school teachers, and in those days it was males only at first, to become officers attached to the schools. a move intended to ensure that proper standards and controls were in place in the management of schools, school and camp activities. I signed up and spent the next 2 weeks at St. Anne's Fort. I see Major Braffitt here. I was under his tenure. I spent those 2 intense weeks. But then I continued with John's advice, because this was the whole concept of the cadet officer was new. I continued and I joined the regiment. But I also had a very interesting experience when I signed up for the regiment. I turned up for the medical, and the nurse took my weight, and she couldn't stop laughing. And she said, "You came to the garrison, but I think you came to the wrong side. The jockeys are over the other side." So, and I said to myself, only John Kelman will get me involved in this. That was John. He was always influencing me. I want to talk about John, the school teacher. And I want to say here that I respect John a lot. John was with, there was about four of us in that group. He could have gone into the private sector. After teaching for a few years, I went into the private sector. I went to Mobil, Shell, Sol. The other guys, Clifford and Peter, went on to cable and wireless. John could have held his own in any of these professions. He was equally sharp. He opted to stay with what he loved. His passion was teaching and young people. So on graduation from KFL, he joined the teaching service and taught at a number of schools and institutions across the country, including he taught mathematics at Combermere, he taught physics at Harrison College, he taught mathematics at the Garrison Secondary, now Graydon Sealy. He was a physics demonstrator and tutor at KFL, and he also taught computer studies at the Metropolitan Knight Institute, so he had a varied contribution to the teaching service. He was into teaching, and he told me he would stay. He went on to complete both his certificate and his diploma in education. He was a dedicated and committed teacher and loved physics in particular. A young lieutenant, John Kelman, joined the staff of the law school in September 1989. He taught physics, mathematics, and integrated science. He was a dedicated member of the chemistry and physics department for over 20 years. Over time, he rose through the military ranks to become captain and eventually major. When the title major is mentioned, we immediately think of someone who is in charge, commandeering, a shout of orders, a no-nonsense person, tough and unyielding. And while Major Kelman possessed these qualities, John, the colleague and friend, was the antithesis of this. He was quietly authoritative, meek, humble, decisive, gentle, but firm. Such qualities do not equate to weakness, as some would have it, but give strength, character, and humanity to this gentle giant. He was a meticulous and competent teacher who enjoyed teaching physics. And during his career, he was also a table leader for the Caribbean Examinations Council. Though he was ill in the end after 2019, John persevered to attend school. So determined was he that he completed, and I'm saying this in his last days, that he completed the student reports and the graduation speeches a mere 2 days before he passed away. He turned up at school when he probably should not have been there, but that was the John that I know. He did not complain about his illness. He did not feel sorry for himself or engage in self-pity. He went on business as usual. When it was apparent that the climbing the stairs was becoming difficult for him, he was asked to exchange labs. But he responded by saying, "Thanks, but no thanks. The exercise is good for me." He did not want things to change because of his illness. And I am quoting Mr. Griffith, his colleague and friend, remembered that his favorite saying was, "And this too shall pass." Major Kelman was an avid sports lover. He will always give of his time to the PE department during inter-house sports and will assist in any way possible. He also loved to hang out with members of staff and was witty and tactful. One remembers well his trying to pass a baton over his head with his feet during an activity, teachers versus students. He brought the house down with laughter. Beverly Paris gave an outstanding mention of him as a Toastmaster, so I'm not going to regurgitate what she said, but for sure he despite being busy with being a teacher and being an officer very heavily engaged in the cadet corps, he found time to function as a Toastmaster and to function in a number of positions, president, vice president. He was regular in attendance, even when he had health challenges. And he didn't just attend these sessions. John was a contributor. He served. He gave of service. I now want to speak about Major Kelman, the officer and gentleman. Major Kelman was a man consistent in character. Even in the military environment, he maintained his calm demeanor, his cool temperament, and his quiet composure. He was never the type to be heard shouting, as we say in the military, tearing the bar off of you. But cadets knew that there was a line not to be crossed, and they also knew when they were in close proximity to that line. He was effective before even raising his voice. He was regular in attendance at cadet camps, meetings, and other cadet activities. Even though he joined the Barbados Coast Guard in 1982, he did not actually get involved with cadets until way into 1989. And once he was involved, he would go on to spend the next 3 decades in this capacity. He was taken on strength as a potential cadet officer in 1988 and became an officer commanding of the No. 3 Cadet Company, Combermere School, in 1989. By 1986, he was OC of the No. 2 Company, the Law School. The No. 2 Company has benefited from its stabilizing influence for more than 2 decades. In 1997, as the Cadet Corps grew, it was necessary to expand the Cadet Headquarters and provide the much-needed support to Major Skeet, Major Patrick Skeet, who was at that time running the Cadet Headquarters single-handedly. The approach was to invite school teachers to serve 2 years full-time in the Cadet Headquarters, bringing the individual skills and experience to assist with the development of the Corps. John was the second teacher to work full-time on the secondment in the BDF, specifically with the Cadet Corps in the capacity of admin officer, and he served in that capacity from 1997 to 1999. He was quietly very efficient and level-headed. I want to relate an experience that I had during the cadet camps of August 2013, where I found myself in a difficult situation. I was battalion commander for the special units, which included the band, the sea cadets, and the medical units. And I was also camp commandant that year for a camp for the sea cadets, which is a large unit. And we would spend the nights at Queen's College, and then we'd head to the HMBS Pelican Fort for training in the day. We were short of officers for this phase of the camp. And to make matters worse, my son was born on the 25th of June. That year, in less than 2 weeks, I was leaving my wife and my son to spend 24-hour sessions in a camp, obviously looking after other people's children. Obviously, that doesn't go down very well at home. You leave yours to look after others. I was so desperate for support. I was desperate for support, and I called my good buddy, Major Kelman, who, though attached to an infantry battalion, graciously agreed to assist me, including a few nights, so that I could go home occasionally and attend my family at this really sensitive time. He responded in the affirmative and turned up to assist in short order. At the end of the camp, when I was compiling his attendance, I was surprised at the number of days that he had put in. He certainly put in more than I had asked for and than I expected. But that said, this is the John I knew, reliable and dependable, another reason why we were such great friends for so many years. In 2004, the Barbados Cadet Corps was celebrating 100 years of establishment in Barbados. And I remember that the cadet CEO at the time, Major Patrick Skeet, was seeking assistance in establishing a theme or a punchline to sell this occasion to the public. And those of us in attendance will remember Major Kelman standing to his feet and boldly declaring, 100 years, more than a century. And of course, for a mathematician and a physician to get up and say 100 years was more than a century, he brought the house down. And every time this is something that we rag John, even until the day probably he died. He would never live that down. 100 years, more than a century. I want to talk now about John, the father, stepfather, and grandfather. John has one son, Kareem, who was born to Harriet Holder. He had no hesitation. I had no hesitation when he asked me to be godfather to Kareem. He later reciprocated as godfather to my son, Sanjay. He was stepfather to Ayanna Phil Sejor and grandfather to two, Jason and Jaden, who delivered a tribute first off this morning. Kareem, his son, recalls on occasion he offered his father an opportunity to drive his Toyota FX, giving him specific instructions, really recommended RPMs or revolutions per minute at which he should change the gears to allow for a smooth transition. John was not convinced about this car and remained skeptical. As a matter of fact, he never drove that car, which is a surprise because as John is quiet, but he's also very daring, okay? As a child, John took Kareem to swimming lessons at Browns Beach, sometimes participating in the exercise, and taking Kareem into deeper water to test his progress. They will always finish off with a race, and then John will give him a lecture about the wisdom of life and how to display honor and dignity while being humble. I want to speak now about John, the husband. Sandy met John, and I'm careful to say it wasn't that John met Sandy. Sandy Field met John at the law school one evening, October 6, 1996. She was there to start a girls' guys unit and was bowled over by his poise and his good looks in his military uniform. The two began dating and eventually married on December 30, 1997, so that moved pretty fast. Opposites do attract. Kelly, the quiet, gentle, and unassuming partner. Sandy, the more vocal, outspoken, and outgoing, the sort of energizer bunny of the relationship. John was committed to Sandy, his wife of 25 years. I know for certain that she was equally committed to him. She cooked, cleaned, pressed, and she would always tell me she's pressing his camouflage and looked after John. Theirs was a relationship based not on material wealth, but on time together, presence, and companionship. There was a lot of compatibility between John and Sandy, their affectionate names being Poopsie, which was John, and Poogie, which was Sandy's. They could be seen together at church, dinners, and parties. They loved gardening, and they loved their three dogs. On December 17, 2022, last year, they celebrated right here in this church 25 years of marriage with a ceremony to mark the occasion. Kelly spent every summer attending one or more of the cadet camps put on by the Barbados Cadet Corps. And as such, he never got to travel and enjoy the luxury of a true holiday. Kelly developed some health issues in 2019. And of course, this was a defining moment in how he lived his life thereafter. Diet and exercise became his regular routine as he was determined to manage this health issue. Sandy related to me that within the last 2 weeks before his passing, she noticed that John was reading his scriptures daily. When asked why he was reading scriptures, he retorted that she had told him, if you really want to see Jesus, you should read the scriptures. When she asked him about the possibility of their first cruise in December 23, he quietly answered, if I am still around. More recently, she reminded him that the new school term was about to begin the following Monday. He responded, I'm not sure that I'm getting back there. It was as if John had a feeling that his time was nearing because these were his utterance. On the traumatic morning of April 12, a.m., where Sandy struggled to get him into the car and get him to Sandy Crest, John, before he took his last breath, the very last words he said to Sandy were, Sandy, you're a good lady. I will meet you at the gates. John was not your typical ill person. He had his challenges, but he never complained. Not even to Sandy. I was his good friend, and I will call him. I will visit him when I was in the island, but he would never complain. Whenever I ran into him or visited him at home, he would be in good spirits, and our meetings will never be rushed. We will talk as friends should. Now, in 2020, I migrated to Antigua to pick up an executive position, so I saw less of John. And I could not get home for his anniversary. I couldn't get home at all because of regional travel. It was just really in a bad state, as you know. Very difficult to get flights. In December 2022, regional travel was in a very, very bad state and flights were limited. Despite an early invitation from John, I could not get home to the 25th wedding anniversary celebration. I returned to Barbados early January and spent 3 days, January 5th to 8th. It is strange, but I had the extraordinarily strong urge to check with John before heading back to Antigua. You know, you grew up in Barbados, or people say the spirit bid me. It was very strange. I was so strong. I had 2 single days to do so many things, but something was saying to me, go and spend some time with John. And I made the effort, and I'm so happy that I was able to do that on January 7th. When I got to the door, John gave me a warm hug, a warm, wonderful embrace. And I spent the next 3 or 4 hours there with John. We drank some fruit juice, because we're not drinkers, we talked. We discussed a number of issues. We talk about the Cadet Corps. We talk about the No. 2 Company Law School. We talk about the cost of living. And interestingly enough, we talked about retirement. I told him that I was growing weary of being out of the country. And I spent almost 38 years in the oil industry, and I was planning to shorten my assignment in Antigua and come home. He surprised me by informing me that this was his last school year and that he was calling it quits at the end of term 3. I had no idea that this would be the last occasion that I would physically interact with John, but I am extremely glad that I made the effort and the sacrifice to see him. He was my friend. I recall the WhatsApp conversation between us on January 8th, the day after I visited him. At 10:02 hours in the morning on January 8th, John wrote to me, "Safe travels. Good seeing you again." And to hear that from John, John is a very conservative, reserved person. He must have been touched deeply. He said, "Good to see you again." And my response at 11:36 after I had checked in for my flight, "Good morning, John. It was truly nice to see you as well. Stay safe and stay healthy, my friend." My good friend and fellow officer, John, lived a good and fulfilling life. He loved his family. He loved teaching. And he loved the Barbados Cadet Corps. He was dedicated to the development of the young people of this country, and his record will certainly stand the test of time. For me, he is gone too soon, but I'm happy that we met and became the best of friends. Farewell, John Anderson Kelman, aka Yellow Pinky, aka Little Sarge, aka Jungle Bear. May fair winds and falling seas accompany you. Thank you.
Yes, you can applaud. You can applaud. I do not, well, in a way, this is all working out properly. I do not intend to give a long sermon. I really don't, because we've been here long enough already. There are a few things I want to do, however, and I said, "Lord, should I do that?" And this morning, I had the privilege, I think, I won't call it a privilege, of looking at, well, as preparing my sermon, in fact, finishing up my sermon, looking at the coronation of King Charles III. Where I thought myself, and because that, as you know, the English, and I'm certain Canon Major Max Springer will tell you that too, and will boast about it, that if you want to see well-ordered, well-orchestrated ceremony, that's the English. Well, I thought, when I looked, I thought, good, well, I'm in good company now, but for sure. Because they were talking, one of them, do this, do that, and move here, move there. And I thought, so not me alone do that thing then. I thought, it all worked out, yeah, but this body pushing, but this body, but I said, good. So sometimes you do have, okay, for that, why am I doing that? I want to recognize the presence in the sanctuary, and there may be others as well, some of my colleagues who are here. And the fact that you have that number of colleagues tells us how much John, not was, is loved. Among them we have, I don't remember what to do, I don't trust this here. So I'm Canon. It's Canon a Henderson guy who taught with him. Henderson, please stand. Henderson is here. Father. Okay, and then we have Reverend Esther Willoughby, who is in the cadet corps herself, and also the pastor at Park Wesleyan Holiness, Esther Reverend Willoughby. We have also with us in Reverend Rosalind Harper Johnson, very special lady, very dear to my heart. Also, we have among us Canon Max Springer. Is he back here? Max is here? I thought I saw Max earlier. We also, for sure, have Father Omar, who would Father Omar, and we also have, of course, Father Charles Dominic, who also many of these Catholic reverends were here for the 25th as well, and of course we all know Father Weber Stephen, who would not and could not miss this funeral. Father Weber, our administrator. And we have, of course, we have Deacon Michael Gonzalez. We'll ask him to do the introductory prayer. And then we have, of course, Deacon George Wave. I'm missing somebody, you know. Who am I missing? That's it? Hello? And of course, oh, good. You're making me a reverend now, too. I know that Hayden Gill is here, but so Hayden, we recognize the presence of Arthur Silver and Hayden Gill. Hayden, I hope you hear that call to the diaconate. That's one thing. Also, this morning, while I was here, I was not using my phone, but I had to look at it because Bishop Nils Canterbury would want to be here, but he had a minor up, and therefore can't be here. But he extended condolences to you. And why I looked at the phone is not because of him, because I spoke to him earlier, but that he was sending me a message, and this is what the message says. A message that he forwarded. Good morning, Bishop. Hope you're keeping well. I had hoped to be at the funeral service this morning in thanksgiving for the life of Captain Kelman, but now I'm unable to do so. I taught with him at the Lord's School. Please, if possible, offer condolences on my behalf to his lovely wife, Sandy, take a bow, and extended family. Blessings. And the Bishop Neil said to me, the above came from Bishop Michael. So the Anglican Bishop sends condolences to you as well. And I'm certain there may be other ministerial colleagues who are in church this morning. If you are there, I extend welcome to you to our celebration here today. My sermon, and I'm looking good. I'm going to make sure I ain't go beyond the time I gave myself. Normally, I preach on the gospel, no matter what the ceremony. But some words kept leaving. I said, I know I got with gospel. And I said, I got it. The text, although I'm going to dwell more on the text itself, but the one that leapt at me from the gospel is, when the Lord saw her, he felt sorry for her. Do not cry. And I checked out the word cry. It did not say weep, and that cry was normally when people cried at funerals at that time, it was the cry of despair. Because the very early Jews, some of them felt, the Sadducees, for example, they felt that when you died, that was the end. So when you cried, it was a cry of, that's the end. And all of them said, don't, it's not the end. Don't cry, the word he used, the Greek word he used, meant, do not cry as if it is the end. No, it's not the end of your son at Nain. And of course, we know the rest is, we know what happened there. My text this morning, the life and the death of each of us has its influence on others. Do you remember that text, right? It was read to the second reading. The life and the death of each of us has its influence on others. If we live, we live for the Lord. If we die, we die for the Lord. So that alive or dead, we belong to the Lord. Church, did you hear those words? I hear those words so often. And it struck me possibly when I sat down on Tuesday to prepare the sermon for Major Kelman. If we live for the Lord. If we die, we die for, because alive or dead, we belong to the Lord. There's so many of us who believe that this is the end. I saw it clearly a couple weeks ago. This is the fourth week of Easter, yes. 5 weeks ago, I saw it clearly. On Good Friday, I checked. My church was packed. This church was full. Every church was full. Good Friday, full of people, packed. You know why? We know death. We see death. We understand death. Come, it's a good crowd on Easter, but not as full as Good Friday. We somehow or other, it ain't hit us yet, you know, that this is not the end. There's a beautiful poem we grew up on. I do not know if they still teach poetry learning in school. At that time, it was a stupid poem. That's why I had to learn stupidness. But I don't know why, because I used it so many times. Some of you know it. Tell me not in mournful numbers. Life is but an empty dream. For the soul is dead that slumbers, and things are not what they seem. And then one says, life is real. Life is earnest. And the grave is not its goal. Hear the words. Dust thou art, to dust returnest, was not spoken of the soul. I don't know, just stupid thing. But I know why, because it's so true. I was too young to understand that then. I understand it now. He said, you see, have you heard the words? Life is real. Life is earnest. And the grave is not its goal. Dust thou art, to dust returnest, was not spoken of the soul. And then there's another verse left to me, at me from that chapter. Art is long and time is fleeting, and our hearts were stout and brave, even to the point of lifting weights and becoming a bodybuilder. Still, like muffled the drums are beating, funeral marches to the grave. Funeral marches to the, no matter how brave we are. Look at these officers. Boy, officers don't get old here. Yeah? I'm old enough, so I can, you know. I used to be like that at one time, but age can't mean, you know. You know, funeral marches to the grave, you know. John's life and now John's death. If it mean anything, let it influence us to respect and to reverence life. This is real, yes. But unfortunately, this has to give way to that. But that is not the end. Almost every funeral, I remind people of that. That is big and bold there. There's a reason for that, you know. You see that there? It's big and bold there. I preached about that yesterday at another funeral. And doing it again. George asked me for doing it again. You see that there? I remember once I had a funeral here years ago as the administrator here. And at the end of the funeral, they said, Reverend, that was a nice, I like this funeral you did. It was a sweet funeral. But Reverend, something had me bothered. I said, what happened? She said, come and let me show you. She said, you see that? Take that down. That troubled me whole time. Because he's not dead, he's alive. I said, lady, thank you very much. You are the one person. I have a church here. We have church every day. And you're the only body that came in here and recognized why that there. Thank you, lady. Thank you very much. That is there to tell us, I said, lady, how much we are loved. And to tell us that what you came to the other day was not the end, that conquered not only that the death there, it conquered all death. The life and death, finishing now, the life and death of each of us has its influence on others. John's life had an influence on me. I met John, first of all, I knew Sandy long, 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 because I knew her father. Father had a son, you know, very close. And son, father, yes, son, how are you? I'm getting married. I said, what, Sandy? And she said, yes, Father, and I want to do the wedding, and I'm going to cathedral, Father, and I want to meet my fiancé, Father. John, come, John. And in what this rather straight-tailed coy, that's the word I'm using, C-O-Y, this coy-looking figure. And I said, good. I said, you got a mind. Yes, Father. I said, and your name is, I'm John Kelman, Father. And I want to say, my gentleman, you sure that's what you want? But I didn't have the courage. And then I said, okay, Sandra, look, so. And so I said, John, are you I'm a Catholic? He said, no. I said, I might be for, no, Father. That's she answering him. I said, I asked John, not you, Candy. And then, of course, some of you know, when we have to interview the people, you have to interview them separately. And so I said, Sandy, please wait. I have to speak to the gentleman first. And then I realized, this is not a coy being, you know. This is a confident being, but a very quiet one. He answered, yes, no, so, no. Ask me again, no, yes, whatever. And very, very, I said, oh, Father Paul, you got that thing wrong here. This. Okay. And that was it. And then when I did do the wedding, there were the army people and so on were there. But that was the and I was impressed with that. And then when I became a chaplain in the army, John is in the army. I said, the army? John? And that gentleman gave me, is he in the army? Because I know officers, can I take a license, please, to do this or what you want? Army officers are, the army officers. I said, well, Lord, I have to put a microphone in him or to give the orders. Because that's not the John. I don't associate John with the army, with the shouting and with the commanding and with the, and yet when I went as a chaplain, when I went to the there was respect there. Eh? When it was, I thought, ha! But so there's something there that told me. I never told you, but I'm saying it about you. It kept telling me, no, there's room for the simple. There's room for the ordinary. There's room for the quiet in any sphere of life. What any sphere of life needs is confidence and faith and at-homeness. Hear my words, I mean my own word, at-homeness with oneself. This man was at home with himself. And because of that, quiet as he may seem to be, there's that confidence, there's that quietude, and there's that tremendous love for a lady. Here it was, a quiet man marrying I have no more to say, except to say that I had the wonderful privilege of celebrating the Mass and preaching at the 25th anniversary. Some of you know I send out a morning message every morning. I try my best to do that. I pray, and I pray for every single person, then I ask them to send this and message. And normally I send it, and Sandy gets in, she's prayed most mornings. And that particular morning, remember Sandy? I do not know why, there's no reason why. It's half past four minutes, 5 in the morning, you know. And after that, I said, let me call Sandy. And I call, Father, I'm taking John at the hospital to Sandy Crest. I said, what? No reason why, I just called. And I thought, I started to pray for him. She said, pray for him, people. And then she called back and said, Father, I've just lost John. And we prayed. And we prayed together. The life and death. His life told me something, the way he lived. His death told me something too. Alive or dead, we belong to the Lord. John belongs to the Lord because our God, to God, and that's the passage, the last part I left out was the same passage, Romans, to God, all are alive. May he rest in peace. Amen. We stand and have our intercessory prayers.
Your response after each petition, hear our prayer. Dear friends, in reverence, let us pray to God, the source of all mercy. Gracious God, forgive the sins of those who have died in Christ. Lord, in your mercy, remember all the good they have done. Lord, in your mercy, welcome them into eternal life. Lord, in your mercy,
let us pray for those who mourn. Comfort them in their grief. Lord, in your mercy, lighten their sense of loss with your presence. Lord, in your mercy, increase their faith and strengthen their hope. Lord, in your mercy,
let us pray also for ourselves on our pilgrimage through life. Keep us faithful in your service. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Kindle in our hearts a longing for heaven. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
The Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Heavenly Father, hear the prayers we offer here today in gratitude and thanksgiving for our brother, Major John Kelman. May these prayers rise up to you like incense, and may they be for us a deepening of our faith and its entry into eternal life. And this prayer we make through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be seated for the offertory hymn. And I'd like to recognize the presence of Reverend, I almost call our minister, sir, you better think about that, yeah. Minister Dwight Sullivan. Yes, Minister Dwight Sullivan, please, and we want to welcome you, and former Minister of Health, of course, friend and brother, Jeffrey Bostick, and of course, very special to me. God bless you, sir. Bless you, sirs. Good to have you in our midst with us, celebrating our offertory hymns.
I love you, Lord.
time for the collector.
Of the goodness of God.
as we prepare, we're coming to an end, please. I know we have been here long enough already, please, so, but we're coming to an end. Actually, before the final commendation and farewell, we want to recognize the presence of the President of the Democratic Labour Party, Dr. Ronnie Yearwood, is he here with us? We're happy to have you, sir. Welcome, God bless you. President of the Democratic Labour Party. Please, before we do the final commendation and farewell, Mrs. Kelman would want to say a few words. Mrs. Kelman, I don't know how you can make it a few, but anyway.
Good morning, brothers and sisters, and to all the supporters who have been traveling and working and journeying with me through these last 3 weeks. I just want to say that on behalf of our Pootsy and Poogie, that's what we refer to each other as, I just want to say a really heartfelt and deep thank you from the bottom of our heart. We always work in core, our heart, for the support that the Army, the Cadet Corps, Heather Leslie, Harriet, my choir, my wonderful melodious choir at Black Rock, the band with Neil and Chris, all of the technical persons, the Lodge School staff, Desmond, who has been my support since John, and he's going to follow in John's footsteps, I told him that, to the principal, Mr. Douglas, at the Lodge School, to John's family, his son Kareem, his grandchildren, and his girlfriend Anne Harriet, to all of the persons, Judy, St. John, his brother-in-law, Margaret, Ronald, who have been there for me. Yes, I'm a strong, resilient woman, as you can see, but that faith comes from God and from Our Lady. I really strongly believe that, and I want to say that some people might not have been able to, because John died in my arms at 4 o'clock at Sandy Crest. And as the eulogist said, he said, "Sandy, you're a good woman." And I knew I was a good woman to him. "And I will meet you at the gates." So that comforts me to know that my husband could tell me that he will meet me at the gates. And I am going to live my life, the rest of my life, working towards getting to those big white pearly gates, along with my sisters at Black Rock, who really comfort me and who have been there for me, saying the rosary. John and I said the rosary at night in the mornings. We prayed the scriptures. He read Matthew 12, Psalm 25. That third verse in Psalm 25 is very telling to me now that he has gone. And I want to say to you all, because it's for the living, be strong, but be strong in God's faith. That is what keeps us, and that is what's going to sustain me, because I still have to continue my life working, etc. I have all the dogs to look after. And I want to say to you all that y'all have been really an excellent support over the years, and I hope that we will continue to live that sharing life. Life is not about, you know, the fancy car and the big material things, because I did not have that with John. We had one car for 25 years to lodge and back for 25 years. And I was contented, because I have learned that life is short and we have to really, you know, share with each other whatever we have. Some of us have more than others, but that does not. Your most important thing is to live that life for God and Our Lady, which I do. And thank God I have my support from the choir and my church, Father Andrew Rosiak. And continue to give me that strength, because I'm going to need that strength. From Monday morning, I'll be a woman, a single woman, joining the Widowers Club. And I want to say that to the persons at Lodge School, I will be back there in September, hopefully, to either teach soft skills or sign language or open a Girl Guide unit, which is what I went to do at Lodge School 25 years ago. So on behalf of John, Kelly and myself, I just want to say thank you, and I'm going to miss him, because he was my rock, even though I am the one, the energizer bunny. But people have to understand that in life, it takes two people to tango, and one has to be different to the other, because other than that, what will happen? one has to bounce off energy. And I know that I did that with him, and he would tell me, well, Sally, how am I going to keep up with you? So you have to keep up with me. When we go dancing and all that on the dance floor, he would always be bringing me a drink, but I'm dancing by myself. And we did everything together. We discussed everything together. Even if I disagreed, because I have my own opinion, but life is not about not agreeing or disagreeing. It is about sharing. And what I had most of all, and I want to say to all the persons here, especially the young people, life is short. Share and say what is in your heart. So if I saw John in a shirt he didn't like, I would say, Pootsie, take off that shirt. You can't go anywhere in that colored shirt. You can't wear that to Lord's school. That is what a relationship is about. It's about caring, sharing, and taking each other's interests and developing it. And yes, I am the doer in the relationship, the energizer bunny. But when I got home, I took off my independent hat and I became a wife. I used to drive to Lord's school and bring cheesecake for him. And he would say, son, you burn gas to bring a piece of cheesecake for $7 up here? I said, yes, John, you are my rock and it's you that I love. So say the things that you should say, because in life, in death, sorry, you cannot say those things when the person has parted. And I think because I did that in my life with him, I told him everything. Oh boy, you look so dapper. I'm sorry, you couldn't wear the new uniform. I said, John, you look so regal, so handsome in that ceremonial uniform. And we used to go on parades together and all of those things. That's what a relationship is about. It's not about being up there, all the big jobs and the big car. It's not about that. It's about heart, and sharing and caring for your partner. So I have had a good 25 years with John, and I know I will meet him at those gates, and I will have then the rest of my life with John. So thank you, all of you that participated, the funeral home. I mean, Ian, you have John looking like 25 years old, and I mean, I'm so, you know, bowled over by how he looks. You know, he looks like how he was. He died how he lived. Very, very, very simple. And he wanted to be buried in the military cemetery. And he wanted an ordinary box. And I said, he told me that 12 years ago. So it tells you that we talk. So I'm encouraging all of y'all here, especially the young people, when you have your partners, say what's on your mind. Even if it is not, I would say, John, we really have to stop now to go to a meeting. And he would say, yes. He would wait on me 3 hours when I'm at Black Rock for the choir, and no fuss. I would wait on him an hour or two. When I'm driving, he would say, oh gosh, Johnny, need a chafet ice cream pistachio. He said, but Sandy, we pass all your chafets. I said, but we have to go back and get it. That I'm a spontaneous woman. So I just want to say that those were the qualities of John. And thank you. Thank you so much. I love you. I love you all. Thank you.
Sandy, if I knew you were going to do all that, I wouldn't have to preach. You preach the sermon. You do a better job than me. Please stand. Please stand for the final commendation.
I missed anything?
No. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully meet him again when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself.
So now we will, this really is the final. We're going to be sprinkling the body again with water. And the reason behind that is again, as a sign of ascending back to God through the same sign he was given to us. Saints of God, come to his aid. Hasten to meet him, angels of the Lord. Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High. May crowd who called him sake take to safety to Abraham. May crowd of angels welcome you. May Christ who called you take you to himself. May enter into the bosom of Abraham, receive his soul,
and present him to God the Most High.
O Lord. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord.
Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother in the sure hope, sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. Merciful Lord, turn towards us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and we are with you and with our brother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Major John Anderson Kelman, may the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and take you to the holy city, the new and Jerusalem. May choirs of angels welcome you, and where Lazarus is born no longer. John, may you have eternal rest. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord.
And let perpetual light shine upon him.
May he rest in peace.
Amen.
May his soul and the soul of all the faithful depart the mercy of God rest in peace.
Amen. Amen.
Now, Father Andrew could not be here. He too had a medical procedure done, but I'm certain he's here with us in spirit. So I'm telling him. So the bread will be taken for burial now, and we're going to sing the hymn, To God Be the Glory. We're going to do it this morning. We're going to sing. We're going to have everybody sing the first verse and chorus. Ladies sing the second verse and chorus, and we do the first verse again. With the men singing, and then we take the body. Okay, so we get the body now. To God be the glory, everybody. Okay. I recognize James Paul.
Great things he has taught us, great things he has. I can see it in your eyes that you are. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never. Worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before, your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Worship your holy name. Bless you, Lord. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending.
10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy.
Great is thy
a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender. I'm in all of you, where you're
Our brother John has gone to his rest in the peace of Christ. May the Lord now welcome him to the table of God's children in heaven. With faith and hope in eternal life, let us assist him with our prayers. Let us pray to the Lord also for ourselves. May we who mourn be reunited one day with our brother. Together may we meet Christ Jesus when he who is our life appears in glory. And we read in sacred scripture, our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we also await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord Jesus Christ, by your own 3 days in the tomb, you hallow the graves of all who believe in you, and so may the grave a sign of hope that promises resurrection even as it claims our mortal bodies. Grant that our brother may sleep here in peace until you awaken him to glory, for you are the resurrection and the life. Then he will see you face to face, and in your light will see light and know the splendor of God, for you live and reign forever and ever. Amen. And because God has chosen to call our brother John from this life to himself, we commit his body to the earth. For we are dust, and unto dust we shall return. But the Lord Jesus Christ will change our mortal bodies to be like his in glory. For he is risen, the firstborn from the dead. So let us commend our brother to the Lord, that the Lord may embrace him in peace and raise up his body on the last day.
Join. dear friends. In reverence, let us pray to God, the source of all mercy. At the end of the petition, Lord, in your mercy, your response again will be, hear our prayers. Gracious Lord, forgive the sins of those who have died in Christ. Lord, in your mercy, remember all the good they have done. Lord, in your mercy, welcome them into eternal life. Lord, in your mercy, let us pray for those who mourn. Comfort them in their grief. Lord, in your mercy, lighten their sense of loss with your presence. Lord, in your mercy, increase their faith and strengthen their hope. Lord, in your mercy, let us pray for ourselves on our pilgrimage through life. Keep us faithful in your service. Lord, in your mercy, kindle in our hearts a longing for heaven. Lord, in your mercy.
And with the longing for the coming of God's kingdom, let us pray, our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
God of holiness and power, accept our praise on behalf of your servant, John. Do not count his deeds against him, for in his heart he desired to do your will, and his faith united him to your people on earth. So may your mercy join him to the angels in heaven. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
We'll sing our next hymn.
Thank you.
our let us pray and bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. Merciful Lord, you know the anguish of the sorrowful. You are attentive to the prayers of the humble. Hear your people who cry out to you in their need and strengthen their hope in your lasting goodness. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Eternal rest, grant unto him, O Lord. May he rest in peace. And may his soul and the souls of all the faithful departed through the mercy of God rest in peace. And now let us all go in the peace of Christ. Thanks be to God.
Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. We agree.